Hi, my name is Antonis, and today I want to share with you how I paint a mural using as my reference an amazing mural from the great iconographer Emmanuel Panselinos. I will paint Saint John, as you see here, the theologian. He's painted by Emmanuel Panselinos on the 13th century. This mural is in Protato in Mountain Athos. I will start quickly just by saying that I'm not using egg tempera here. I will use this binder, this acrylic binder. It's a glue, and this will be the binder for my powder pigment colors. So I just show you here that I'm using one part of this binder with approximately two parts of water, and I will shake well this mixture, and with this I will use this emulsion instead of egg tempera. So this is a demonstration of how I paint on a wall. Of course, I will not here use an actual wall, but I will share with you exactly the technique that I'm using when I'm painting on a wall. Here you see how to use this mixture of glue and water with pigment. And if you are interested in or are planning to paint al seco on a wall, then stay with me. We will learn, and I will show you all my knowledge on how to paint on a wall. So here you see me, I have already transferred my drawing on this board. This is a wood board, but I have prepared it in a way to resemble a wall. It's not prepared with skin, rabbit skin glue, but instead it's prepared with an acrylic gesso. And I will start with the same technique as in icon painting, transferring my drawing, and then here do my underpainting a little bit. I'll just paint with black the outlines of my drawing. This is exactly what I would do on a wall. I would sandpaper the wall to make it clear, and then I would transfer the drawing and start painting the background. Here you see me painting a clear layer of that glue water emulsion. This is a way to make my gesso less absorbent a little bit, so that colors will keep their brilliance, their actual color, and will not become more cloudy, let's say. So after you have transferred your drawing and your outlines on the wall, just you can always paint a layer of clear transparent glue to make the wall lose the absorbency. Then, as you see here, I will start regularly painting my background, my halo. The background, I like to paint it black. It's very common in the Cretan tradition. Manuel Panselinos on the 13th century painted blue, light blue or darker blue backgrounds. It's really beautiful as well. And here you will see me painting my proplasmi, the base colors for each area of the cloth. I know this is too much too soon, but I really want to ask you how are you, and communicate a little bit more with you, see how, ask you how you are, if you are healthy, creative. I just the video is running, and I have to tell you all this information about wall painting. So I hope you are well. I hope you are healthy, and stay with me for this video to see how I paint this Saint John theologian. It's one of the rare times that I paint in this Macedonian style of Emmanuel Panselinos. This is again the name of the iconographer that had painted the original fresco on my reference. This fresco again is in the Protato monastery in Mountain Athos. You can check it out. The murals of Emmanuel Panselinos in that monastery are truly spectacular. It's one of the best examples of the Byzantine art globally. Anyway, so here I'm using my that acrylic emulsion that you saw me creating before, with regularly my powdered pigments that I use for egg tempera. And with larger brushes, they are synthetic for the most part here, I will start by painting my base colors for each area. I will not refer to specifically what colors I used for each area, or maybe I will later on. Now I want to talk a little bit about the halo when we paint a mural. First, I drew the halo, the outline of the halo, before I painted my background, and I knew where to paint black and where to paint yellow. This will help me now, where I will use the compass again to write the halo with a compass and give it a more professional, more steady line around the compass. For this, as you see here, I attached a small thin piece of wood on top of the face, and I knew where the center of the halo was, because I drew it before. There was a tiny little hole on my wall, and I have a little sign on this little wood, and I placed that little sign on top of the hole that is on my face. So again, here I know exactly where the center is. Again, this might be confusing the way I communicate it, but I'm sure that the visuals will help you. So I know where the center of my halo is, and now what I have to do is attach a brush on my compass, and with this brush I will dip the brush in color, and I will write my halo. Here you see that I have attached a brush that is not very flexible. I would say it's a rather hard brush, and if you actually work on a mural, you can use a larger compass like this one here. And here, as you see, I'm using this compass and the brush to write the halo. Take your time, try to keep your brush your compass constantly centered, and it takes some practice. Sometimes this feels very unsafe, feels very I don't know, it feels very easy to go wrong, but with some patience and little by little, you will manage to do it. So here, this white line that is written on the outer side of the yellow halo, I placed the radius of the compass to be right in between the yellow color and the black background. And little by little, I do this. Hello. Now here it's in the middle of summer. It's very hot, and colors dry very, very quickly. This helps create this line nice. Otherwise, just wait a little bit for your first layer to dry and write a little bit later on. So after this first white line, I will use a deep red color to write the inner line. I will lower the radius of the compass a little bit, and do not really, when you try this, don't freak out. Sometimes it's very hard to achieve. Make sure that your brush is appropriate. Here I will push the compass all the way down so that I will write this line with all the force of my brush. If I just use the tip of the brush here, the line will not be very steady. So I will force my brush all the way towards the board so that the line will be steady and full. Hopefully you do understand what I'm talking about, but if you try it, you will definitely understand how to write hello. This is very satisfying because you see a line that is very steady, very nice, and very professional looking. This is exactly how to write the hello on a wall. And again, this is exactly what I would do if I had to paint on a wall. So, if you are interested, I have also this online course.
Hi, I'm Antonis, and I'm proud to present you my online course in iconography, Paint an Icon with Me. This course will help you become a better iconographer, and it will help you be more confident when talking and presenting your artwork. It will make you understand in depth the studio practices of a professional iconographer like me, and you will get accustomed to what great iconography looks like. So, learn in a simple and organized way everything you need about the materials, mediums, and techniques in order to make a beautiful icon. Paint with me the icon of Christ and learn how to paint better any icon you wish. I will see you at the studio.
It's a course. This is a course consisted by 25 videos. It's more around 9 hours of content where I teach you everything I know about iconography, how to paint an icon of Christ from scratch. And the good with this course, the great thing about this course is that you can apply all this knowledge, not of course on that on the specific icon that I paint there, but I've organized this course in a way that you can apply this knowledge to everything you would like to paint. So if you are interested, check the information below. It's on the description of this video. Check the course and see if this might be something useful for you. So back here to the fresco al secco technique that I'm teaching here. Unfortunately, I've lost the part where I paint the grapsimata of the Holy Matthew of Saint John here, but you can see the you can take the idea. And now I'm painting the second light of this clothes of Saint John. Now this technique here on the wall is called al secco, painting on wall al secco with dry, let's say, where the plaster is already dried. It's not a fresco painting where the plaster is still wet and the colors become part of the plaster, are incorporated with the plaster. This technique, of course, is much more durable. And we have murals, fresco murals that are here with us for centuries. This arseco technique is probably less durable, but it's much easier because you don't have to deal with wet plaster and be in a hurry to finish the painting before the plaster dries out. Fresco technique is an amazing technique, it's really wonderful, and I would really like to dive more into that. But until then, I'm happy with this arseco technique. It's very easy and very close, very similar to icon painting. So here you see me painting the holy clothes of Saint John. It's really satisfying because the scale is bigger when you paint on a mural, and it's different than icon painting in the sense that you have to understand that these icons, these murals are to be seen from far, and you have to work on a more free, more less detailed, let's say, way. Than in icon painting. This can be very satisfactory, and it frees, it makes me paint in a more free, more natural, let's say, way. And of course, this is the technique of the Macedonian so-called school. The Macedonian is different enough to the Cretan that follows chronologically. It's, I would say, more naturalistic way of painting here. And here, a third light. So for this holy Matthew of Saint John, as a base, I used ochre, yellow ochre, some black, a little bit of blue, and a little bit of cadmium yellow, approximately these colors to achieve this greenish earthy color. I noticed that Manuel Pansellinos placed his lights with a bluish tint. They are a little bit more bluish than the proplasmos. So after I painted this greenish proplasmo, I did darker, my darker grapsimata by adding some black and some iron oxide red as well, a little bit. And for the first light, I just used some white, some black, a grayish color that I also bluish it. I added also some blue to give it this cold color. And subsequently, for the second light, I added a little bit more of white. And for this third light that you see me now painting, I've used pure titanium white. This Macedonian style paintings have a lot of movement in them. They do feel more naturalistic than the Cretan ones, and they are much more, let's say, painterly than the Cretan icons, I would say. Of course, the Cretan icons have their own charm, their own beauty. It's, I think an iconographer should try all styles and enjoy icon painting out of every style. Here you see me painting these grapsimata here using a larger brush. This is not a Kolinsky brush here. Kolinsky brush can be used in fine details, but I would say for mural painting it's better to use larger and a little harder brushes than the Kolinsky brush. So let me know how your summer is, how your life is, if you are in the studio. The more we interact with other people this summer, the more I realize how hard winter was for everybody. It was a difficult period, but we are lucky to be more in our studios and be creative. It's something that kept many of us sane and balanced, and I'm so grateful for that. I hope you also took advantage of your time and spend some time in your studio. Let me know what painting is for you, if it does help you emotionally, if it does give you some comfort the way it gives me. I'm truly very, very grateful to be able to be in the studio and just play with my colors, just create something. Do my studies, these videos for you. Another blessing for me is to be in touch with you and communicate with you. So thank you so much for your kind presence in this channel. It's really, really nice. Thank you. Now for this color of the cloth of Saint John. For the proplasmo, I've used the pinkish color. I've used some cadmium red, some white. I didn't want this to be very, very strong in pink, the proplasmos, I mean. So I've also added a little bit of blue and a little bit of black, just to make it a little bit more grayish. And subsequently, for the grapsimata, I've darkened those with some iron oxide red and some black to make this grapsimata darker. And as you saw, I added an even darker grapsimo, that is iron oxide red with some black. For the lights of this cloth, I've added some titanium white, some cobalt blue, and a little bit of the color of the proplasmo. And for the second and third light, I've added some titanium white. The colors really, as I've said, the colors I use, it's something that might help a lot of you, but generally speaking, I would say that more importantly when learning iconography is not to learn recipes, but learn ourselves how to produce a color, to observe, let's say, our reference, and try to imagine, try to guess what colors the master iconographer has used in order to create this specific color. This will teach us how to produce colors and to imagine the process of icon painting that the master iconographer used. This is like learning how to fish instead of just having one fish ready. All my students, I want to understand the color theory, and I'm pretty sure I'll do a video soon on that, giving you some exercises in color. It's very important to understand the wheel of color, the warm, the cold colors, etc. It's very useful in iconography as in painting as well. And I truly believe that a great iconographer should be able to paint, to be able to paint something from nature. I don't think that iconographers should just paint icons. I believe that know how to paint a naturalistic subject. From subjects from nature will inform your icon painting, and if you want to become a better iconographer, then also try to work from life, to paint from life or from a photograph, but a naturalistic subject. So anyway, here back to this painting here, I've noticed from the reference that the γραψίματα on the face of St. John, as painted by Manuel Paracelsus, are much more dark than those in the tradition of the Cretan style. Of course, here it's summer and works in homes are everywhere, so you might be able to listen to a wheel screeching. This neighborhood people take care of their homes anyway. So the γραψίματα here are much darker and than in the Cretan tradition. Why? Because this mural was to be seen from afar, and if Paracelsus painted the γραψίματα very close to the color of the προπλασμός, then people would not be able to see them from afar. So here, for the color of this προπλασμό, people often say that the προπλασμός in the Macedonian style is much lighter than that of the Cretan tradition. I'm not really sure this is true. I noticed from my reference here, and you can also go back in the video where I attach this reference, that the προπλασμός of this Saint John is pretty dark. Of course, we have examples of the Macedonian style that the base color of the face, the προπλασμός of the face, is much lighter. This tells me that we shouldn't just have a specific recipe and put these labels that the proplasmos in the Macedonian style is lighter, the proplasmos in the Cretan style is darker. No, we should be open and keep our eyes open to our reference. And also let ourselves experiment a little bit, see how things we can vary. I know that beginner iconographers, my students beginning their journey in iconography, want specific answers, specific recipes and tags, but iconography is something rich, something dynamic. Even these masters, once they used lighter colors, the next time some darker. I think we should keep our minds open when it comes to iconography, and try to avoid recipes or cliches in our mind. What is true though, and the great difference between the Cretan style and the Macedonian style, is that, as I said, the Macedonian style is more naturalistic, more painterly, and this shows in this first light of the face where The shapes are more dynamic than in the Cretan style, and of course more broad. They cover a larger area of the proplasmo, and they don't have that ascetic, very simple, very almost minimalistic look of the Cretan style. They are more lushy, more broad, and the colors used in them can be also more rich and dynamic as well. So here, when I'm placing these shapes now of the first light according to my reference, I notice that they have this dynamic that for me is something unusual, since I rarely paint in this style, although I enjoy it so much. I'm from Crete, I live in Crete, and I support the Cretan style. No, I'm just I'm joking, of course. I love all kinds of iconography, but usually I paint in the Cretan style, in the Cretan tradition. This brings me to another subject that came in discussion the other day with some friends about iconography that is a blending between the Paleologian style, the Macedonian style, as we say it, and the Cretan style. I think it's better to not mix these two, to not take elements. Of course, they are connected, and it's they are very close to each other as as painting styles. But for those of you who are deeply into iconography, it's better to just keep things separate and to not see elements of the Cretan tradition in a Macedonian, let's say, icon, and vice versa. Anyway, this again is a matter of style. I don't want to be very, dogmatic here. Painting for me is painting, and the important thing is to enjoy it, to feel better in our studio, and if that means that you have to blend the two styles, go ahead and do it. Anyway, now after having placed these shapes of light on the head as correctly as I can, I will now start blending this first light with my proplasmo. For the first light, I've used titanium white, some yellow ochre, and some cadmium red. And now for this first blending color, I will use some of that first light. I will add some black, some cadmium yellow to give it a little bit more bright yellowy hue, and a little bit of yellow ochre. This will be the first in-between color. Of course, many will follow. As you see here, I'm still using the tip of my brush to blend. This is a residue from my Cretan training, my Cretan experience as an iconographer, but I've noticed that Panselinus as well has these little lines on the forehead of his painting here. When you paint a mural and you are actually very far away from the viewer, for example, you paint 20 meters above the ground, then you will understand that these lines really do nothing for the viewer, and you have to use more broad, more, let's say, more lively brush strokes than the tip of your brush in order to give the viewer the feeling of the illusion of blending. Here I'm still I'm very close to my to my painting. I mean, this is not an actual mural, so I try to be thorough and do a blending that is as fine as I find appropriate. But when you paint on a mural, you can be more more bold, let's say, with your brush strokes, and that's the beauty of the mural as well. So here I'm doing this blending. I go from that first blending color to darker blending colors towards the proplasmo, and also more bluish. I will try to keep this very iconistic, let's say, element of the Macedonian style, these bluish transitions between light and shadow in the proplasmo of the face. I know that this might be very, you know, too deep for many of you, too much for many of you, but it's just nice to these things, you can understand them when you are painting these references. And the best way, I believe, to enjoy these videos and to learn these videos is when you are actually trying to paint this same reference or something similar. So now I'm doing again more blending by going from these darker blending colors back to lighter blending colors, and eventually to a color that is very close to my first light. Let me know if this makes sense to you, if what I'm talking about does teach you something, or if it's more confusing and more hard for you to understand what I'm talking about. Sometimes I believe it might be better if I just play some music with the videos and let you just watch the video. So I want to thank so much my patrons for supporting me on patreon.com. If you want to support this channel, you can find me on, you can find the link on the description below. And it's really amazing, those people, my patrons, do support me, and they bring me closer to my goal, that is to be a full-time painter and being able to produce these videos, you know, without the issues of my actual teaching job. Anyway, thank you, my patrons. You really rock. You are amazing. And I often upload exclusively on Patreon. You can check my page there and see the posts that I upload. Here, still I'm doing this blending. I'm in between the first light and my proplasmo always. I think that in this Macedonian tradition, where psimithias have a different, let's say, purpose than those in the Cretan style, I will explain later what I'm talking about. The most important element is this, the blending from the, just achieving a nice first light and the way it blends to the proplasmo. So pay some attention here, try to be, try to do a nice job, and when you are done with this, then your job is done. Because the second light of the face is much more easy to place than in the Cretan tradition. So in the Cretan style of painting, the psimithias, the second light and the third light on face, not only serve to give some light, some more light on the face, but they are decorations themselves. They are used as an element of beauty by itself. So the Cretan iconographers pay a lot of attention to these lines and the beauty of these lines. This is something manieristic, I would say. It's not something that really serves to light the face. The way here in the Macedonian style, the iconographers don't actually care of the beauty of the line itself. They just understand the importance of the psimithia in order to give in order to lighten the face. In the Cretan style, they understand that psimithias do light the face more, but also they perceive those as decorative elements, and they bring those into another level. So here you see how much more, let's say, bold and easily we place these psimithias. We paint these psimithias. You can try this technique on a wall, maybe of an old room. It's really nice to paint on a wall. It's very different and very satisfactory. I just want to say for the board that I've used exactly the same technique of preparing a board. You can find this technique in one of my videos, how I prepare my boards. And but instead of using rabbit skin glue, I've used a similar acrylic glue that I added one part of glue, two parts of water. So I have three parts of liquid in my cup, and then on that liquid I added six parts of powdered gypsum, and with that gesso I prepared this board. I didn't sand it down very much because I really wanted, as you see here, to have this wall feeling on it. Let me know if you have any questions. You can find me on my email account. The description is below. My account is on the description of the video below, and I'm glad to answer any questions, see your paintings. It's really a pleasure for me. Sometimes it's hard for me to answer immediately, but I do see them, and eventually I come back to you. I'm also planning in organizing some online courses, not very many. The seats are limited from this coming October. So if you are interested, let me know on my email account that you'll see below on the description. I do have some opening seats for that lessons, and there will be lessons of maximum five people in each group, and let me know if you want to know more about this Zoom online course. It's offered in both Greek and English. So anyway, here back to this painting. I'm almost done with this second light. I'm placing these psimithias, and then I'm doing some blending, and then going back just to to make this face more, let's say, convincing. I'm amazed by these old masters. I'm observing the eyes that Manuel Pancellinus painted here, now that I'm doing the eyes of my study. And it's really unbelievable how these masters, how talented these masters were. And I don't know, it's just something that makes me so to admire them so much. Their mastery, their way of painting. I don't know, the expression that Manuel Pancellinus gives on his figures is just amazing. Of course, you know the famous Christ from Protato Monastery that he has painted. It's just a masterpiece of iconography. I don't know if we can achieve this level of mastery today. It's really something unbelievable. Of course, the devotion these people had on their art was significant. We have so many other things to do. I don't know. We have so many other distractions that it's hard to achieve a level of mastery like them. I don't know. At least we try. We spend time in the studio. I hope you do, and I hope you really, really enjoy your time there. Here I'm doing the beard of Saint John, and the more I look to my reference, the more I admire Manuel Pancellinus about his broad brush stroke, his understanding of the human figure, and the way he translates these elements into iconography is just unbelievable. So here, another difference of the Cretan style to the Macedonian, as I've noticed, is that in the Cretan style, we cover all the head with one color of proplasmo. Here, Pancellinus uses a different color of proplasmo for his beard. It's a more bluish-grayish color than the green-brownish color of the flesh part. So he uses a different color of proplasmo for his beard. Here, on that proplasmo, I've painted with a lighter color some basic shapes of the hairs of the beard. And now I'm doing some outlines of the darker areas of the beard with a darker color. And what will follow is a third layer of color, which will be the some actual lights, the highlights of the beard. Here, I use very freely the brush. This was a very nice, very satisfactory painting in iconography, because as you see, I'm using the brush in a very painterly, very nice way, and this is the beauty really of this Macedonian style. It is both contained, both controlled, and at the same time it has a freedom that is very, very beautiful. Here, of course, the lights in the eyebrows, and now I will go a little bit lighter with this beard. I hope you find this video helpful. You learned something. If you learned something, please like this video and share it with somebody who might be interested in iconography. Now, after painting this beard, our Alseco mural is almost finished. Here we don't have to varnish anything. We don't paint with ectempera on a wall. Ectempera really is not a material to paint on a wall. This technique is really great. We already have murals with acrylic glues that are more than 30 years old, 40 years old, maybe older, and they look great. These acrylic glues that we use as a binder are very durable, also if you paint with them outside a wall, on a wall that is outside. Of course, it's best if your mural is not attacked by humidity, like constant humidity or rain or something like that. If it's protected from this, your mural will last, I'm sure, for centuries probably. I really like how this face is almost done. It's really nice, I think. And of course, all the bravos should go to Emmanuel Panselinos, who really created these figures, these images that are that will inspire people for as long as they exist, and they are truly spectacular. Now some final corrections, adding a little bit of warm glazes, lighting some areas and broadening maybe some others. I really like that dark proplasmo. It gives this painting a very, very nice depth, I would say. So don't be afraid to use dark base colors. They are very charming and very nice. Again, thank you so much for being here. If you paint this Saint John of Patmos, of course, this Saint John is the Saint John who wrote the Revelation, Apocalypse. He wrote it in Patmos, and he was the beloved student of Christ, a major, of course, figure of the Christianity. And it's pretty amazing how Manuel Panselinos captured this beautiful, beautiful expression in the eyes of Saint John. So this is almost done. Hopefully you learned something out of it. Here I'm doing some final glazes. In the video they seem a little bit stronger than in the actual painting, just to emphasize a little bit this bluish part of the transition between flesh and proplasma. It seems a little stronger in the video than in the real life, but it still looks okay, it looks nice, I think. So anyway, thank you so much for being here, for your amazing comments and your beautiful presence below. Check my online course if you find it interested, interesting and be creative and be healthy. I will see you soon with another video tutorial. Bye.